Alright everyone, welcome back. Our next talk is Fuzzing the TCP IP Stack with Ilya. Please give him a warm round of applause.
Great. Thank you for the introduction. As was just mentioned, I will be talking about fuzzing the TCP stack, going beyond the trivial. Just a fair warning, and I'll get into this a bit later, this is a very, very early pre-alpha version. There is more to come, but I have some things to talk about and report, and hoping to maybe move the kind of current state of this a bit further. Right, so who am I? My name is Ilya. I have been coming to the CC Congress since 18C3, which is really not a way of saying I'm old and decrepit. I've in a handful of those times, I've also spoken here before. I spoke on some issues with clearing memory, which I called memsad. I spoke on some X11 things about a decade ago. I spoke on some Windows stuff. I did a general fuzzing talk about 15, 16 years ago. And there were a few others that I can't really remember because I'm old and my memory sucks. What's really cool is it's really, really glad. I'm really glad to be back here after 4 years. Yeah, right? Yeah. Absolutely. Oh, man. It was almost going to happen last year, and then I guess something happened. It didn't. But hey, here we are. All good again. Hopefully, we won't have to wait another 3 or 4 years for the next one. I'm definitely looking forward to the next one already, even though I guess we're only halfway through. But yeah, that's kind of who I am. I work at a company called IOActive. We do computer security. I do code review and pen test and fuzzing and all those kinds of things. You know, I'm a security kind of consultant slash engineer. What am I going to talk about? I'll have a slide kind of talking about the audience that might be interested in here, but if you're here, you probably only know who you are. And then I'll kind of go into a little bit of the history of doing TCP/IP stack fuzzing and this like low-level network fuzzing, and kind of where the state is today, and then kind of move on to where I see it going, what I will be the crux of what I'll be presenting, and then sort of the how do we go beyond that, and then the kind of middle part of my talk is kind of the where I'm at. So, sort of how I want to do some, or how I envision doing sort of the quote unquote next level, whatever that means, of TCP/IP stack fuzzing. You know, and I'll talk about kind of what I want to fuzz and how I want to fuzz it, and I'll talk about the setup, and I'll talk about certain modifications I made to network stacks to try to make this happen. I'll show how to get all this thing set up and how to kind of usage of the stuff I've been that I kind of built, and then I'll do a small demo. And then after that, if anybody's still in the room, I'll take questions. So the audience, I mean, you know who you are, but if it isn't clear, if you like fuzzing, this might be interesting. If you're a network geek, this might be interesting. If you're an operating systems guy, this might be interesting. If you like technology, you might like this. If any kind of sort of security, network, OS, fuzzing, then this may be for you. But even if you don't fall in that category, you might still find this interesting. So let's get into kind of the history of things, right? So I'm obviously, you know, not the very first guy to go, hey, you know, we have these TCP/IP stacks and they take network packets and they parse bits and bytes and they handle state. Isn't that interesting? Surely that's attack surface, right? In fact, you know, you go back to the 90s and probably before that, but you know, I wasn't around before that. So if you look at kind of the state of network stack bugs in the 90s, it was sort of very trivial stuff. For those who were around, you might remember like WinNuke, and we had things like SynFloods and Ping of Dead and, you know, Smurf and LAN and Teardrop and Bonk and all these mutations and Boink and what have you, I wouldn't say they were really a result of fuzzing, but they definitely were some kind of result of some kind of runtime testing. I think at this time, very few people were actually doing any kind of targeted code review or fuzzing, but people were at least, you know, people observed certain bugs in the network stack and observed that they could write tools and exploits to use them mostly for things like denial of service. But that's kind of where this starts, sort of mid-90s-ish, with these kind of trivial tools. None of this should work today, but that's kind of the history starts of this. And then we kind of get into the late 90s and the 2000s, and we had some libraries like LibNet and things like that. And somebody wrote this tool called ISIC, the IP Stack Integrity Checker. And ISIC is really, really cool. Somehow, it's one of these tools that not many people, everybody should know about them, but you know, when I talk to people, oftentimes they'll be like, what is this thing? And then you go download this thing that's 20, 25 years old, and you run it against network stack, and sometimes bugs come out. It was extremely successful back in its day. It would break Windows up to Windows 7. There was some nasty bug in the UDP handler. It's broken the Linux DHCP stack several times. They twiddle with their stack often. So sometimes stuff breaks and they fix it, and then 2 years later, it breaks again or something else, and so on and so on. It's definitely broken the NetBSD DHCP stack. The top three I know because I hit those bugs too. And then kind of the bottom ones, the like Checkpoint Firewall and the Gauntlet Firewall and the Raptor and so on. I never observed any of that because I don't have access to that hardware. And of course, that hardware, I mean, this is basically from their trophies file, which is from the late 90s. And so these are kind of products of that time. But like dot, 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 because this thing really used to break everything. And on occasion, it still breaks stuff, right? The way ISIC really works is it understands the structure of an IP packet and the structure of a UDP packet and a TCP packet and an ICMP packet and an Ethernet frame. And it just, you know, bit bangs around and has some options to go, hey, do you want to fiddle with these flags or TCP flags, or do you want to fiddle with IP options or TCP options, or do you want to mess with a checksum? And then it just keeps this one buffer and then has this loop, and it just keeps changing a few bits and keeps firing these things off. The speed of ISIC is really pretty bad, pretty insane. Like it's fast. But it's limited, right? It doesn't understand any kind of state, while it finds a certain amount of bugs, there is beyond a certain point, it can't get beyond that. It can't find those bugs, right? But even so, this is kind of where we've been stuck for 20 years, right? This was kind of why I wanted to do this presentation. You can use SCAPI and do similar things with SCAPI. The reason I like ISIC and still like it today is because it's very simple C code and it's just blazingly fast. Anyway, how do we go beyond this trivial state? We've been stuck here for 20-something years. It's time to move on, right? As I mentioned before, it turns out TCP, which sits on top of IP, and some other things, has state. And you can ask network engineers and people that build these network stacks and so on, there are bugs that sit behind these state that if you just throw packets at it without ever getting into the state, you will never hit these kind of bugs, right? You just can't get there with crafting simple packets. You need to like complete your three-way handshake and like set up like the right extensions and the right flags, and like I send you this and you send me this and I send you this other thing and you send me this thing, and all of a sudden you get into this weird state where maybe some bug happens, right? But that's pretty deep. That's pretty deep into like your network protocol. If you're just banging out some bits, you never get there, right? And so getting to this point and trying to fuzz beyond that, this is hard and it takes a lot of time. As I said, the state really hasn't advanced much beyond this. There's been some research the last couple of years, because I kind of Googled around for these things. And so there's this NVIDIA 33, and then there's this academic paper, TCP Fuzz, where they kind of use this network stress slash test tool by Google, which isn't really a fuzzer, but you can kind of coax it into like becoming a fuzzer-ish, called Packet Driller. And so they found some interesting things with that. And I'll kind of circle back to these things a bit later. So of course, you know, with the enormous success in the last decade and change of things like AFL and AFL Plus, the first thought is, aha, let's use coverage-guided fuzzing, fantastic. Let's do that. And that would be great. It turns out it's not that simple. There have been attempts, and in principle, yes, you want to do coverage-guided fuzzing. It's not easy. There are some problems, right? So first of all, AFL and AFL++ work incredibly well when, A, you have a file where really all of your state is maintained in the file, or you have a very simple API where you go, here's data and here's a length and go parse, right? It works exceptionally well for those situations. And a lot of attack surfaces like that. A network stack doesn't quite work like that, right? It's not a file. It's a protocol, which means there's things that get to state that isn't like one bit inside of a packet, right? So it's this weird thing that is like encoded in a series of things. It isn't like represented by one bit or one byte or like a length field or something like that. That's one. The other one is packet queues. What I mean by packet queues is basically, so if you, let's say if you have a network, you have a file parser, usually you have like file parse function, and you have a length and a pointer, and it parses the thing, and it returns, and it does something. When you do a network stack, because it is so tightly integrated into the bowels of your operating system, what happens is a packet comes in and the NIC kind of sees it and it triggers an interrupt and the interrupt handler kicks in and goes great and it kind of takes it from the interrupt queue and then it looks at it and it goes, oh, this is Ethernet, I'm going to put this in the Ethernet queue, and then at some point your Ethernet handler wakes up and he goes, oh, great, I'm taking it out of this queue, and he goes, oh, this is IP, great, I'm going to put this on the IP queue, and he goes back to something else, the IP queue at some point wakes up, takes this thing off the queue and goes, oh yeah, great, this is IP so-and-so, oh, it's TCP, yes, yeah, I have an open TCP port, great, I'm going to go put this on the TCP queue, and then the TCP queue at some point, you know, TCP threat wakes up, takes it from TCP queue and goes, yes, I know this guy, I've been talking to this guy, I have a userland service that's running, I'm going to take this thing and give it to the userland guy, and the userland guy just called receive, and receive now return, and so it's you have a bunch of these steps. It's not linear. It's not one, two, three. It's one guy and then somebody else and then somebody else and then somebody else. While you can instrument that, it's not quite as simple, right? As I mentioned, the other one issue is the state can't easily be captured in any kind of file or set of data. It's really like a sequence of things. So that's where things get problematic. And there are people that have, you know, discussions and people have tried. Someone said, hey, you know, we actually tried with AFL and we got somewhere, but they said, you know, we ran into problems, which is exactly what I was talking about. The queues, asynchronicity of it all makes it very difficult. It doesn't mean you can't do coverage-guided fuzzing, but it means it requires an extra set of work beyond what we've done before. My opinion is we have to work towards getting this, but we are very far away from it. Getting that done in any kind of way that is reproducible and easy to set up. Doing like a one-off where it works for one guy and then getting to some level of fuzzing, that's what this guy is describing, right? But getting that to any kind of level where we can repro that and make it, you know, not make your life miserable when you try to set it up, nowhere close to that. So as I said, this is why like the fuzzing CV state is just hard and time consuming, and I'm definitely not here to talk about coverage guide fuzzing. I just wanted to kind of see where we're going. I write code. I do, you know, I'm lazy, right? So, and the thought I had is instead of doing that, what we really want is I want to have my own network stack that I can fiddle with and then talk to somebody else's network stack and I basically, you know, modify this network stack so that it adds fuzzing. And because the network stack's already there, I get all the state for free because the stack is doing that. But as I said, I am lazy. There's no way I'm building my own network stack. But the good news is I don't have to, right? If this was 10, 15, 20 years ago, you would have been out of luck and you would have had to do that. But today, it turns out, we have a number of usual anti-CPIP stacks, right? They're often used for like in embedded stuff or to test certain things. Somebody wrote a port scanner with it. Like you can do all sorts of things with it. But somehow, as far as I can tell, no one's ever looked at it and said, great, let's go co-opt one of these network stacks and turn them into a fuzzer. And that was kind of the idea I had. That's kind of the crux of this presentation. One of the things I did is looked around and said, okay, what's out there, right? And it turns out there's quite a few. There's libuinet, which is a port of the BSD network stack to userland. It's fairly old. It hasn't been touched in 8 years. I have no idea what its current state is. I just looked at it, the timestamp, and I was like, I don't want to mess with this. It might just be too painful. There's PyTCP, which is a fully functioning network stack in Python. I considered using that. It was a bit too painful for what I had in mind. It does, like it comes with its own like DHCP server and things like that. And that's too much. I don't want that. I just want the network stack. There's a few others. I looked at NetStack, which is Google made this as part of their gVisor products, offering, whatever. NetStack used to be a separate thing, and then it somehow got moved into gVisor, like the repo. And trying to separate one from the other, I'm sure there's a way to do it. I tried, couldn't quite get there. I didn't spend much time on it, but I'd say couldn't get it done within an hour. And that was kind of like, okay, you're out. I need something easier. There's LWIP, which I know is used in a few places. There's small TCP, which is a TCP stack entirely written in Rust, which is very exciting. Pico TCP, UIP, there's a bunch of others. I settled on Pico TCP, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Before I get to like the actual implementation and kind of testing I did, what do we actually want to fuzz? This isn't really a hard question, but you know we should determine this before we actually set out to fuzz this thing, right? So yes, the idea is we take a usual anti-CPIP stack, we modify it to fuzz the right things. We get the state for free because the TCP stack already does that. But what do we then want to fuzz, right? And the answer then is, okay, let's go look at the protocols and see what's there and where we know there's state and where we know things go wrong and where we know things have gone wrong in the past, right? Basically, stuff where there's complexity, right? And if you're looking at, for example, TCP, like obviously your flags, they tend to signal things and cause transitions in states. You know, obviously a SYN or a SYNAC or those kind of things tend to cause transitions in state. Window sizes are interesting. They've definitely they're kind of subtle. They seem trivial, but they've caused problems in the past. So messing with window sizes is a great idea. Checksums shouldn't be a problem, but I have seen problems where checksum functions will read out a bound by 1 or 2 bytes. So on occasion, checksums are a problem. Obviously, the size of packets is interesting, right? If you know, what happens if you get a zero-sized packet, right? Is that even legal? Spoiler, turns out for UDP it is legal, for TCP it is not. What if you send really large packets? What if they're larger than the MTU? What if you use jumbo frames and so on? Some of this triggers fragmentation, some of it doesn't. And obviously, the obvious one is length fields, right? Can we mess with length fields? And then obviously fragmentation is interesting, right? We know there have been plenty of bugs with fragmentation in the past. We know there's going to be bugs in the future with fragmentation. So that's definitely something you would want to fuzz. And you get into all sorts of, is it too big or too small or too many or not enough or out of order or some stuff timed out or some duplicates, or you set a don't fragment flag but you fragment anyway. You know, you get all of these weird fragmentation things. And then sort of lastly is, you know, options, right? So IPv4 options, TCP options, IPv6 extension headers, right? Insertion, truncation, removal, out of order, any of combination of these could be interesting, could lead to some kind of issues in state or parser or a combination of both. So that's stuff that we would want to fuzz. So as all of these may or may not relate to state. I care in the sense that I want to get to state, but I also don't really care in the sense that, because I already have a username TCP/IP stack, it does the state for me, so I just kind of piggyback off of that. And then, of course, you can just build on upon it, right? It's like, okay, well, what about ICMP? What about SCTP? What about IDMP? And so on. For SCTP, it's like, okay, Pico TCP doesn't support it. I wanted to use UINET, but I never got that far. So ultimately, I want to get there, but not even close to it. SCTP, by the way, is one of these weird things where, like, if you're a network nerd, you've probably heard of it, but you've never seen it, because nobody uses SCTP except when you get to the telco world, and then everybody uses SCTP, right? So it's one of these really large niches, but outside of that, nobody really uses it. Right, so that's kind of, okay, when I want to fuzz and how I want to fuzz. Let's talk practical things, because I kind of built this fuzzer, right? And it does this thing. So how does that work, right? So, well, the first thing you do is, as I said, you pick one. So I chose Pico TCP, and I'll get into that in a moment. Your steps for setup are relatively easy. Essentially, you set up a TONTAP interface. You play around with like a bridge and like add if and brctl and so on. And then you need something to drive traffic. And so what I did is I created a simple echo service and an echo client. And that obviously you do that in a loop and it kind of ends up driving traffic till the end of time, which is great because now I can just hook into the network stack and start messing with things. And because the you know, the echo client server just keeps sending data back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, that just drives fuzzing, right? And then the last step in the setup is, yes, you need to modify your TCP/IP stack and add fuzzing to normal traffic. So yeah, as I said, I used Pico TCP, and here's why. I evaluated a bunch of these things. Initially, I wanted to go with PyTCP. It was a little bit too hairy for what I wanted to do, but it does work. I was like, okay, PyTCP looks great. I used to write a ton of C code. I haven't touched much C in the last couple of years, but it was nice because I now have an excuse to write some C code, and Pico TCP is, it's pretty simple C code. It's not very complicated. It's easy to get started with it. It's easy to integrate into your own userland program. It's easy to read the code. It is easy to modify, and best of all, it's open source and free software. It's entirely GPL'd. So that means I can do whatever the hell I want with it. Sweet. So yeah, I should have put more in this slide. But essentially, I don't know if you can read the code from how far, but essentially, one of the cool things about Pico TCP is that it comes with very simple, very easy APIs. And so I built a simple Echo client using the APIs. And so essentially, you kind of go and say, yeah, I want the stack to have this IP, you know, I want to, you know, create a socket and then go connect to somebody else on that socket. And that's just, I mean, it's the APIs are really, really simple. Sweet. So with that, I'll do a demo. I'll say this though, lower expectations. I didn't quite get as far as I wanted to. The fuzzer works, just barely though, but it works. I didn't implement everything I wanted to implement. There's lots of to-dos. The fragmentation, for example, I'm not there yet. In terms of trophies, not really any significant crashes yet. I did find a minor denial of service in like the Minix 3 network stack where if I'm throwing packets at it, something else at some point can't connect to it until you kind of stop throwing packets at it. I don't know if that's really a state thing. That may just be that the stack is so slow it can't keep up, even though I'm not throwing packets at it that fast. But yeah, let me do a little demo. Sweet. So here I have an OpenBSD machine, which is running my Echo daemon. And here I have my my fuzzer. This runs on a Linux machine. So this one is 192.168.11.131 or 130, and then the OpenBSD machine is 132. And so you'll see traffic here in a second, and should have. Yeah, sweet, okay. So kind of drive traffic from here, and it goes like, yeah, I'm fuzzing. And then Weezy goes, yeah, I see your packets, and you're kind of fuzzing, and I'm echoing some things, but it's dropping a lot because there's all sorts of things it doesn't like. And then like if you go through this stuff, you'll see a whole bunch of like retransmissions and like some broken packets and all sorts of things. Like it's good enough that packets get through and get processed and make it past the three-way handshake and they get echoed back. It's broken enough that a lot of this stuff doesn't get through and gets stuck somewhere. And my hope is somewhere in there it will find bugs. This code started working this morning at about 6 a.m. yeah, so. the downside is I'd hope to find a bug or two, not yet, which is kind of annoying. But this is about as far as I go with that. It's a pre-alpha version. There's work to be done. As I said, it works, but just barely. As I said, I can force packets through the stack, do the three-way handshake, and sometimes the Echo service even acknowledges and sends it back to me, which is great. Sometimes my Echo client crashes, and that's why I have a bash loop around it. As I said, it's ugly, but it works. And as I said, I haven't implemented fragmentation yet. So lots of work to be done. The code is incredibly ugly, but given and I wanted to get further than I did today, but it does work somewhat. And I put it on GitHub. So if you wanna play around with it, you can. Expect updates in the next couple of days and weeks. I hope to get this in a much better state. It is really ugly, by the way. Currently, I don't actually have a full Pico TCP code in there. I just took a diff, and the diff is kind of screwed up, so I do need to fix it. But everything, if you really want to get it working, everything is there. But in the next couple of days, I will clean it up and make it easier to work with. But if you want to get going right now, it's going to take you some effort, but it's there. But if you hold on for a few more days, maybe a week, I will make sure it works. It'll be easier. I'm kind of out of time, but last thing I kind of wanted to talk about is why stop at one fuzzer, right? One of the really cool things I like about EFL++ is its integration with other fuzzers. And I think that's something we should start doing in everything we fuzz. It's like, why stop at one fuzz? Or if there's something else, find a way to make them work together, to cooperate and collaborate and so on. I mentioned Packet Ruler before. Like, you could definitely get some Packet Ruler in there. Why not throw some ISIC in there? There's the IPv6 toolkit. There's a few others. So I'd say, don't just stop at one fuzzer. Combine a bunch of things. Talk about some previous research. As for conclusion, I don't really have much of a conclusion except for I should have started this earlier and gotten further. I do have long-term goals and a call to action, right? To me, it's clear that using Usenet TCP stack will move the state beyond where we are today with just using ISIC, for example, right? ISIC still finds bugs, but you know, it's 25 years old. Let's have a better approach, right? And so I think using Usenet TCP stack seems very promising to me. I think it's a good move forward. It's not the end goal, right? Ultimately, we do want coverage-guided fuzzing. But I don't think those are mutually exclusive. In fact, I think both will work well together. As I said, doing this currently is very difficult. I'm hoping to, you know, find other people that will want to work on this as well. And my goal here is really just to get things moving and get some ideas going, really. I guess I'm 1 minute over time, but that's essentially my presentation.
Thank you. All right, we have 8 minutes for questions. So if you have any questions, please line up at the microphones and we will take them. And if you're on the stream, you can also ask questions on the internet, and someone already did. So please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the great talk and the great effort in getting it ready for today. One question from the internet here is, where do you see, like, what else do you see that could be done? Like fuzzing ICMP or so on, is like good user land tools also available here? Just what are general thoughts on the landscape?
Yeah, that's a really good question. ICMP, I think, is a good one because, I mean, that's one of these things where usually ICMP packets generally don't come out of nowhere. They tend to come out of something in the state went wrong. Like, you're talking to the TCP thing, and all of a sudden the port closes, and then you get an ICMP going, hey, you know, port closed or something. So that's definitely stuff you can do. To some extent, I have that implemented in the sense that I don't have any code that explicitly evokes ICMP packets, which is something that I think should be added. But I do have code that says, hey, if the network stack generates ICMP messages, I will go fuzz that. So that is implemented. But ICMP is a really good one. There's definitely more work to be done there. I mentioned some of these things before. So definitely IPv6, which I haven't implemented yet. The extensions, I think, is interesting. ICMP here, IGMP is another one, STP. I mean, the opportunities are really boundless and endless, right? So I think it's a great question. I don't have the answer to all of them. I think I enumerated some. There's definitely more. It would make sense as an exercise to really dive deep into kind of every possible thing you can have in your state and TCP stack, explicitly enumerate it, and then go kind of like this goal-oriented approach where you go, have I implemented this? No. How do I do it? Have I implemented this? Have I implemented this? As I said, I kind of ran out of time. I'd like to do this. I haven't done that yet.
All right. We take mic number 2, please.
Hello. Thank you. I wasn't quite clear. Are you fuzzing Pqt TCP? Or are you just using Pqt TCP to take care of a bunch of stuff that you too lazy to do?
That's exactly it. You can fuzz Pqt TCP with this too. It's not what I'm doing, right? I'm using Pqt TCP to be my TCP stack, right? That means I don't have to write it. And then what I did is I basically, the way Pqt TCP works is like, it's not a library that in the sense that like it's on the system. It's a library in the sense that it's part of your application. I compile it with me. And so because of that, I can, the PicoDSP source code is part of my program. So I literally just add hooks in a bunch of places in PicoTCP and go, oh, before you send this out, if it's IP, do IP fuzzing. If it's TCP, do TCP fuzzing. If it's ICMP, do ICMP fuzzing. Add extensions, mutate extensions, that kind of stuff.
So you're fuzzing the remote system?
Correct, yes.
All right, thank you.
All right. Do we have any further questions in the room? No? Internet, go.
Yes. Another one. How do you meter kind of like the underlying stacks? How do you look at branch coverage and so on? Are you doing that already? And how are you doing it?
Yep. That is a great question. That's coverage-guided fuzzing. I'm currently not doing that, right? I spoke about that a little bit. We need to move in that direction. It's definitely, I think that's the end goal, really. The problem, some of the problems I discussed there is that it's not quite as easy as it's made out to be. You're dealing with a low-level operating system, so it's not as simple as instrumenting a userland program. You're dealing with queues instead of files, or like one file parser. So dealing with queues is a pain in the ass. And then you're dealing with state, right? Which means a lot of things don't necessarily encode to one bit or one byte, but it's really a combination of you sent this, and then I sent that, and then this sent, and then so on. And this, you seven or eight different things lining up that then causes a state transition, right? And so it's there's, at least from where I'm standing right now, there's no easy way to do this. As I said, we need to go there. That's the end goal. How we go there, there are certain gaps that need to be filled.
Were you in yesterday's talk about the QEMO fuzzing?
Unfortunately, no. I had code to write.
I think that's a good start.
All right. Mic number three, please.
Hi, great talk. I wanted to ask if it's maybe possible to integrate fuzzing into the Linux kernel itself to fuzz its TCP/IP stack.
Yes, you can. So when you get to like a net filter, there are places there that you can use to fuzz with. I looked into it. It's one of the things I wanted to do. It was on my to-do list once I get done with, you know, where I get with PicoTCP and some other things. And again, it's one of these things, it doesn't have to be one or the other, right? You can combine these things. So that is a great approach. I thought about it. I want to do it. I haven't gotten there yet. That's 10 steps away from where I'm now. I hope that answers your question, but I think it's a great question, and the answer is yes, we should do that.
All right, thanks.
All right, do we have any further questions from the internet?
Yes, we have one, and I think it's very general. So the question here is, have you considered using Rust for the fuzzer itself, like the HyperHTTP mm-hmm. library or something like this?
Yeah. So I mentioned small TCP. So given that there's a network stack for it, you can use Rust. I didn't use that. I like Rust. I think it's a great programming language. I think it's at some point, hopefully, it'll replace all or most of our C or C++ code. I have many great things to say about Rust. I am not a great Rust developer. I've written a little bit of Rust code, but I have a large learning curve. And for that reason, and only that reason, I didn't go with Rust or small TCP. It's my own limitations. I wish I had known more Rust, but you know, life happens, and I haven't had a good opportunity yet to write a bunch of Rust code. Someday I hope to get better at writing Rust code, and I would love to do some of this stuff in Rust, but the only reason I didn't touch anything in Rust here was I wasn't confident I would have gotten anything done in time.
All right. Then we will simply end the talk perfectly on time. Thank you very much, Ilya. Sure.